So delighted that you stopped in today. Our desire is to provide you with scriptural teaching to bolster your personal walk with God. Trust you'll enjoy the selection. May you receive it with an open heart and a spirit of prayer.
God bless you all.
Marriage is what brings us together today. Marriage, that blessed arrangement, that dream within a dream. Then love, true love, will follow you forever. So treasure your wife.
Praise the Lord, everyone, and welcome to another Bible study. Today, here in the Smith residence, we're so delighted to have you to be with us on this beautiful Sunday afternoon. We trust that you enjoyed that little comedic video clip that we enclosed in the beginning of this Bible study. Of course, it is a snippet of the movie The Princess Bride. And something that we always get a good chuckle out of, and a beautiful, wonderful little movie also as well. As you can see, we have elected to delve into the theme of marriage, and we're going to try to share some thoughts on marriage for the next few weeks. It may be 3 weeks, maybe five. We'll just let God ordained that as the days roll out. But today we're going to just, in essence, just kind of give an overview of where we're going to go, give you some thoughts, and then we'll delve into it a little deeper, beginning with next week. Our text for this lesson is found in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 26 and verses 27. And the Bible says this in the King James Version, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth." This, is, of course, is an excerpt from the creation account there found in the book of Genesis. And we understand that God created it, the world. There's nothing that exists that God didn't create. He created the heavens and the earth. He created even all of mankind, you and I. And, of course, in his creation of mankind, he created a male and a female, a man and a woman. And when God created it, you look at the last day of God's creation, and the Bible says that it was very good. Everything that God does is perfect, and everything that God does has purpose. Everything has purpose. Years ago, I attended a church Bible school. I was living at the time in Flint, Michigan, and one of the classes that I took on these weeknights was a class given by a Reverend Miller, and the class name was Divine Design. Catchy phrase, and it was a beautiful study, and a wonderful man who taught the course. But the prevailing thought that was delivered in that course was simply this: If it exists, God created it. And if God made it, it has a purpose. It has a reason for being in existence. And thirdly, in God's purpose, when that which God created is utilized for its God-ordained purpose, it will flourish. It will blossom. It will excel. I've used a Christian ministerial manual during my many years of pastoral tenure in the churches that I pastored and assisted in over the last 35 or so years. And it's published by Standard Publishing out of Cincinnati, Ohio. I've used it in more weddings and funerals and baby dedications and such like than I can. I guess there's no way I could count them all. But one of the phrases that I've read dozens of times in the conducting of a wedding is this. And I take this excerpt from that book. Quote, God loves us and created us to love others. Our lives find completion only as we love and are loved in return. Together, we can become what we could never be separately. Marriage is of God. The point being made here is that marriage is God's creation. It is God's purpose for a man and a woman to be joined together in holy matrimony. It is the oldest ceremony in all the world. The first marriage was created, of course, or conducted in the presence of God there in the Garden of Eden. And the marriage that you and I have will only be productive and satisfying when we structure it and conduct it after God's design. Last night I received a phone call from a good friend of mine, a young man that I knew in my years in South Florida, Miami area, Kendall. I worked in a church there for a few years, and we enjoyed a good little conversation and discovered that he worked in tools. And I made this statement in the course of our conversation, that is this. I've learned that the right tool makes the hard job a whole lot easier. I've learned a long time ago that using the right tool will make a hard job a whole lot easier. In like fashion, the wrong tool will frustrate the process and leave us dissatisfied and oftentimes in a catastrophic end. Marriage is a tool. Used and use it properly and you will have success. Use marriage incorrectly and you will have catastrophic results. Don't use the hammer to try to drive a screw into the wall. And don't use the screwdriver to try to hammer a nail into the wall. You see, using the right tool for the right purpose always brings a more harmonious and victorious end. And so if you misuse the institution of marriage that God created, you will find and have catastrophic results. So in this Bible study, we're going to look at God's original design for marriage. We're going to study the order that God has instituted in His design. We're going to study the purpose that God has established for marriage from the beginning there in the Garden of Eden. We will see how well when a marriage is structured correctly will run, how well it will run, it will be smooth, it will mesh together, and it will be fulfilling, and we will be productive in that marriage. But we'll also look at the possible train wrecks that we might have if we disregard God's design in the institution of marriage and how it will lead us into trouble. Getting into the crux of the issue here of marriage, I want to read and make five basic points, and then I will close on this afternoon to discuss these more in depth at a later date. But in Genesis chapter 2 and verse number 7, we read, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Chapter 1 of Genesis speaks of creation in overview. Chapter 2 of Genesis breaks down the process of creation a little bit more. In my Oxford Scofield edition of the King James Bible, it says there in the heading of Genesis 2 and 7, the creative act of Genesis 1:27 described. But when you look at this chapter 2, verse 7, you will find this point, that in the chronological order of creation, man was created first. Secondly, you look at Genesis chapter 2 and verse 15 and 16, and you see this, and the Lord took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. You'll find there that secondly, we see that man is given a job that he is called to perform. And God gives man, in this case Adam, law dictating his behavior and his activities. Drop down to the 18th verse and then the 21st verse of Genesis chapter 2, and we read this. And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. Verse 21, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman, and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And they were both naked, and the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. So we see the third point here is that after God had created the man and given him purpose and law, you'll find that God looked throughout the created beings, the monkeys, the deer, the elephants, the tigers, and could not find a suitable helper or helpmeet for man. And so the Lord made woman from man, and as I heard one preacher say one time, looking into the original Hebrew of that text, that when Adam saw Eve, he said, wow. He said, wow. And then fourth of all, the woman was made by God with a purpose. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 18, we read, I will make him an help meet for him. I will make Adam a helpmeet, or I will make man a helpmeet. All things created by God have order and purpose, and the woman is no different than any other created being. She was made to be more than just a delightfully pleasant and beautiful companion to man, but she was to be joined to man with purpose. And lastly, there is something missing in the Genesis chapter 2 account of creation. And I've learned through the many years that sometimes we can learn equally as much about those things that God has willfully, intentionally omitted from the Word of God as we can from the things that He says emphatically. God's absence of instruction can be powerful statements in and of themselves. There is one thing in this creation account that speaks volumes, and we will discuss that also in due time. So let me bring this introduction to the marriage lesson series to a close. I always try to keep my Bible studies on Sunday afternoon to about 20 minutes, 15 to 25, and I would rather break it up into smaller pieces than to endeavor to try to cover too much material and then put myself in time constraints. And so, in closing, let me say this. This Bible study was given to me of the Lord back, and I can't really tell you whether it's the late 90s or the early 2000s. I think it was really the late 90s. And he gave me these lessons to endeavor to help a particular couple that was in a church that I pastored that were having marital concerns, marital issues. I think I named this Bible study this: Everything You Need to Know About Marriage You Find in Genesis Chapter 2. Or you could call this Bible study 5 points to setting your marriage in order, or 5 points to structure your marriage after God's design. I would like to say that it worked wonders for that couple that I was teaching this Bible study, but unfortunately it did end in divorce some years later after this was provided. And with that, I must say that the Word of God will only work where there are two participants, specifically in the marriage scenario, that are willing to surrender themselves to the authority of God's Word and the institution of marriage. My dad would always say something like this: it takes two to tango. It takes two to dance the tango. You can't do it all alone. I understand these instructions are going to be perceived as being controversial. The Word of God is controversial. So I don't apologize for that. And I won't be surprised if some of you think some negative thoughts towards me, or even send me a little bit of hate email over these instructions concerning marriage. And that, I wouldn't be surprised, be it from a man or from a woman. I know that not everything in the Word of God will always be agreeable to us as we study it, but it is always true. It's always God's Word. And I'm persuaded that being God's Word, it always works perfectly. And as a personal testimony, I might add in the beginning of this Bible study that I have just celebrated 40 years of marriage myself. I know I look too young to have been married 40 years and somewhat feel that way at times, but these are principles that I have established and tried to utilize in my marriage to my precious wife, and they do work. Yet some people will not embrace the instructions of God regardless, whether it be to salvation, whether it be to child rearing, whether it be to marriage, whether it be to being an employee. There will always be someone that will try to live outside of the Word of God and its instructions. It's a sad thing, because in so doing, people acquiesce themselves to living outside of their privilege. When you live inside of God's Word, you will fulfill your privilege as God has ordained. We will always find someone who will find an alternate means, in this scenario of marriage, to make a lasting relationship. It doesn't mean that it's right. It just simply means that somebody has sufficed themselves short of what God has ordained. It happens every day in God's Word. Somebody falling short or selling them short of all that God has to provide us. But again, I say without embarrassment or without vacillating one iota, and that is, God's Word is true. Let every man be a liar. I hope you'll turn in again next week as we discuss a man in creation. The fact that he was created first has some significance. The fact that he was given instruction has some meaning to us. And I hope that you'll be here for that lesson. But until then, I trust that you've been enjoying these Bible studies, and we have been delighted with the privilege, the honor to be in your home with you again today. I trust that you find these informational, these studies, and inspirational. We're always excited when you drop us a line and send us an email at RevMDSmith@theopendoor.com. www.thefamilyministry.org, and you can see that address at the end of this video. Check out our website and look for the soon to come podcast that we are working on as of right now. And check us out. Look us up on Facebook and YouTube. All of these for one singular purpose: to broadcast the Word of God to everyone by whatever means, and so that everybody can enjoy this precious Word of God and the privilege and the joy that it can bring to your life and to my life. Share us with a friend, and we'll be sure to not embarrass you. God bless you, and we trust that you remain blessed in the days to come. But until we are joined together again, as God ordains, be well. Have a good evening. Bye-bye.